friends, graduates, other students, I'm delighted to be here. And I need to say that over the years, I've been to a lot of graduations and been to a few places. And the only word I can come up with for this site right here is spectacular. This is just a great group of people. And of course, a great historic church and a great city and a great country. But just the looks and the confidence of these graduates and friends and family is something that really inspired me. And the faculty as well. I don't know if there's a better faculty on earth anywhere. This is something. I have a few things to say. I'm aware of the rule that you ought to make a good speech. You stand up to be seen, speak up to be heard, and sit down to be appreciated. So I won't keep you long. But I will say I'm a lawyer. I've been practicing law for starting in 1973. And so I can tell lawyer jokes. And here's one from way back. They didn't just start recently. And this wasn't meant as a joke. In 1777, King George wanted a census of all the people in the colonies. In Grafton County, New Hampshire, where Dartmouth College is now located, and it was located then, the report was made through the county clerk, who wrote as follows. Your Royal Majesty, Grafton County, New Hampshire, consists of 1,212 square miles. It contains 6,489 souls, most of whom are engaged in agriculture. But included in that number are 69 wheelwrights, 8 doctors, 29 blacksmiths, 87 preachers, 20 slaves, and 90 students at the new college. There is not but one lawyer, for which fact we take no personal credit, but thank an almighty and merciful God. I'd like to know the context of that statement. But what I want to do today is I want to ask you to do something. I've mentioned how important this assemblage is. And just from knowing the people here and knowing this school, I can say that you could not have gotten a better education anywhere. You cannot be with more accomplished, more loving, more concerned, more dedicated people than you are in a room with right now. Never again probably will you be surrounded by so many people that care so much about you and also so amply qualified to help you. But I want to ask you to do something. I want to ask you to remember something. And that is, it was said by John Kennedy famously when it came from Luke 12:48. And says, for of those to whom much is given, much is required. So that's my point. The world is bigger than you. It's bigger than all of us. And it is a dangerous place. It's a place of great opportunity, but also a place of great danger. And it takes strength, confidence, knowledge, and understanding in order to be safe and to prosper. The world does not tolerate complacence, weakness, or ignorance. Not for long. John Donne said it very well back in 1624. He said, and I quote, no man is an island, entire of itself. Each is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a part be washed away by the sea, Europe is the less, as well as if a promontory were, as well as if a manor of thine, or of thy friends were. Each man's death diminishes me, for I am involved in mankind. Therefore, sin not to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. What does that mean in our modern language? It means that we are all locked into a wagon, whether it goes up the road to prosperity or over the cliff into the abyss, we go with it. So what does that mean to us? Let's take for a moment a look at the continent that he referred to, a look at the main, and let's see what's going on out there in the world that we'll be confronted with. There are some funny questions that people ask. And here are some that you'll get a kick out of. But the question is, does this display ignorance? Does this display complacence? I don't think these do. These are questions by lawyers given in court proceedings. The question was, now, doctor, isn't it true that when a person dies in his sleep, in most cases he just passes quietly away and doesn't know anything about it until the next morning when he wakes up? Another question asked by in a serious proceeding. The question, was it you or your brother who was killed in the war? A couple more. The lawyer said, I show you exhibit 3 and ask you if you recognize that picture. Answer, that is me. Actually, she knew she said, that is I. I said, that is me. Question, and were you present when that picture was taken? Finally, this is my favorite. Asking the coroner on the stand, Mr. Coroner, do you recall approximately the time that you examined the body of Mr. Jones? Answer, it was in the evening. The autopsy started at about 8:30 p.m. Question, and Mr. Jones was dead at the time. Is that correct? Answer, no, you stupid idiot. He was sitting on the table wondering why I was performing an autopsy. Now, those don't display ignorance. They just display haste. But let's look a little deeper, and you may have seen some of these on television. These are funny answers given by young people mainly, not any of you, I'm sure, but you may remember some of those. They would stop people on the street and ask them, what do you know about the employment rate? What is it right now? Well, about 99% unemployment rate. Question, who is your favorite founding father? Answer, Abraham Lincoln. Y'all know Abraham Lincoln came much later. Question, who was president during World War II? Answer, well, I think it was Bush. Am I close? Question, which country did we fight in the Revolutionary War? Answer, France. Question, in which month do we vote for president? Well, it's in the fall. Is it September or is it October? Question, what special group advises the president? Answer, his inner group. Actually, it's the cabinet, as you know. Who elects the Congress? Answer, the president. How many stars are on the American flag? Well, 32, I guess. Question, where does Congress meet? Answer, in the House of Representatives? No. Question, in what building does the Congress meet? Answer, the Pentagon. Question, who was Andrew Jackson? Answer, one of Michael's brothers. Name a country which borders the U.S. As you know, there are two, Mexico and Canada. Answer, Europe. Question, how many Supreme Court justices are there? Answer, 2. As you know, there are 9. Finally, what once divided East Germany and West Germany? Answer, the sea. If that is a real reflection of the learning and the knowledge of those young people who were given those answers, then we've got some problems. And my point to you is I think that we do have some problems, because here's some hard facts that were taken from serious surveys by serious institutions in just the last few years. In 2010, over 33% of the native-born Americans failed the civics portion of the naturalization test. Of foreign applicants, how many failed the civics portion of the naturalization test? 2.5% compared to 33% of citizens. A 2016 study found that only 25% of Americans could name all three branches of American government. 33% could not name a single branch. More Americans can name American Idol winners than members of the Supreme Court. 9.6% of college graduates named Judge Judy as a member of the United States. Assembly and the fifth one, petition for redress of grievances. That's the one most people forget. In 2011, 29% of the Americans polled could not name the vice president elected in 2008. That was Joe Biden. 73% could not give a basic explanation of the Cold War. 44% could not identify the purpose of the Bill of Rights. And 6% could not find the date of Independence Day on the calendar. In Oklahoma, 75% of the high school graduates could not name the first president of the United States. Only 45% of college graduates could articulate a basic description of the free enterprise system. Only 30% of elected officials knew that life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness are the inalienable rights referred to in the Declaration of Independence. Some people say they're not surprised that their elected officials don't know much. 25% of Americans did not know the country from which we gained our independence. In 2015, only 43% of Americans had read a novel. That gift that had gone down from 60% in 1982 and had gone drastically down from time before that. Only 30% of those born in the 1980s and after think it is essential to live in a country with a democratically elected government. Another 24% of those born in the 1980s or after believe democracy to be a bad or a very bad way to run a country. Now you see why we're depending on you. Because there are a lot of people out there who are not studying these things, who don't understand where we fit into the world, who don't understand what made this country great. It's not the natural resources. There are plenty of other countries, plenty of other places that have the same or more natural resources than we. It's our freedom to grow, freedom to learn, freedom to do what you want, to chase your dream. Those are the things that have made this country so strong and so great. So I think that we are headed for some trouble unless someone steps forward. And that someone is those of you here with the red gowns on today. Will Durant, Will and Eric Durant wrote a lot of books. They're very learned people. And they said that education is the transmission of civilization. H.G. Wells said that civilization is a race between education and catastrophe. James Madison, the father of the Constitution, said, knowledge will forever govern ignorance. People who mean to be their own governors must arm themselves with the power which knowledge gives. He also said, the advancement and diffusion of knowledge is the only guardian of liberty. Translation, knowledge, which means brain power, is what rules the world and what makes the world safe. So my question to you is, what are you going to do about it? And when are you going to stop? Because this is your country. And as I mentioned earlier, for of those to whom much is given, much is required. So I ask you to remember that. And also, I quote this short poem by a French philosopher named Guillaume Apollinaire. I believe it's how it's pronounced. He said, come to the edge. We are afraid, they said. Come to the edge, he said. They came, and he pushed them, and they fought them. So what I've attempted to do today is to push you just a little bit. Every parent, every friend here wants to push you just a little bit, and we want you to fly. We want you to fly high. We want you to remember that this is your country, and we want you to act like it. You hold so much promise. We're all counting on you.